For if by one man's offense death reigned through that one, what? Much more. Those who receive the abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Death reigned in Adam, but in Christ, we reign. Death reigned in Adam and in Adam's descendants, but in Jesus Christ, you and I reign. In Adam, there was tragedy, tragic death, but in Christ, there's triumph. See, this is Paul's argument here relative to this concept of the believer's prospects. It augments our future. He has changed what? Our life. It's a new life, new power, and new hope. Listen to this one more time. Look at verse 20. Paul says, moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. The law comes in to cause the sinner to recognize he is in violation. But where sin abounds, grace abounds. What does your Bible say? Much more. Where sin abounded, grace abounds much more. This is marvelous. This is marvelous. Sin is an incredible, incredible evil entity that works its way out in the lives of every human being that's ever been born. And that's just an incredible statement in and of itself, that 100% of humanity have fallen short of the glory of God and have sinned against God. Sin has reigned in humanity. But where sin abounded, grace abounded much more, such that all of the composites of sin, all sin could never overcome the grace and mercy of God. That God's grace abounds over, not just over, but much more, beyond sin. Sin is incredible, an incredible tragedy that has affected us, but God's grace, what? Abounds much more. So that, in Paul's reasoning, follow it, follow me. So that as sin, I'm in verse 21, so that as sin reigned in death, even so grace might reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. What shall we say then? Now, again, I say to you, Paul is an incredible thinker. And it's almost as if he heard people thinking before they made the statement. Now, why do you suppose that is? Because Paul thought it. Look at the text. Look at it again. Look at verse 20. He says, where sin abounds, grace does much more abound. What does he say? Shall we continue in sin that grace can continue to abound? See, Paul is saying, he's gone ahead of us. Just for those people, those saints who feel like, you know what? Now, if while I'm a sinner, God, Christ died for me and he transformed my life. And now that I'm in Christ, the grace of God continues to abound because of my sin. Then it just seems to make sense that the more I sin, the more grace I get. Now, that's the logic of the fallen nature. The fallen nature wants to make excuse for a sinful life. What? Sin so that God can add more grace. Don't you think God is going to be pleased with that? Paul says, shall we continue in sin that grace can keep abounding? Paul says, God forbid. Absolutely not. In fact, it's a double negative. He says, absolutely, may it never be the case. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? See, the whole point of the resurrection, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ was to give us new life. Much more than what we've had. In Adam we die, but in Christ we're made alive. What a contrast. Our destiny in Adam is death and condemnation. Our destiny in Jesus is wonderful prospects of glorious life for the future. Paul says, look, that we have new life. And he argues this. Look at verse 3 of chapter 6. He says, or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into his death. What Paul is saying here, he's saying that you and I are in a union with Jesus Christ. He says that we've been baptized into his death. The word baptized is the word baptizo, which means to place into. That when Christ died, what the Father did, he took believers, those who placed their faith in Christ, he baptized them, as it were, or placed them there at the scene of Christ's death. He said we were baptized into his death, such that his death, his burial, his resurrection certified, that certification was applied to our account. So as far as God is concerned, when he looks at us, he looks at us as having died with Christ. That we are one with him in his death. Not only in his death. What's amazing, in his burial as well. We were in the tomb with him. Where? In Christ. But what is even more amazing, that even in his resurrection, that we were raised with him. In what? New life. Paul says in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, he says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but it's Christ who lives in me. And the life that I'm now living, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who did what? He loved me and did what? Gave himself for me. See, Paul saw himself at the cross. You see, this is amazing, because this kind of thinking, this fact that we're in union with Christ, is to transform our lives. It's to transform our thinking too about sin. We need to transform and to think differently about sin. You see, if we died with him, then we should understand the tragedy of that death. And so when we're looking at sin, when we're tried, when we're tested, when we're tempted, we need to be mindful that this is what took Christ to his death, and we died with him. We need to examine sin. Paul says what? Shall we continue in it that grace may abound? See, there are many believers today, many people who call themselves believers. And they think that they can continue to practice sin. That think that they, just because God is gracious and God is kind, God is merciful, that they can find a nice little cubbyhole, a nice little soft spot in God's grace and mercy, and he'll just kind of turn his head away from our insistence on having a... No, God forbid. See, the whole point of him dying was to transform that thinking. Not to give us license. Christ didn't die to give you a license, a charge card to sin. When he died, he took your charge card.